We've been taught that the birthplace of the human race is Earth, but it's not.
Jupiter Ascending is a fantastic movie. The fact that our locations are tangible and everything is pseudo-realistic, set in a very fantastical world and done by two of the most brilliant directors that exude so much fantasy and make you believe what you're doing even though it's so incredibly unbelievable.
Like space, it's so exciting. If you're a storyteller, it has the same potential as the imagination. It's just so huge. If you can imagine it, the universe can probably imagine it too.
If you're going to sort of create whole worlds, you really have to design everything, how they live, how they move around, what they wear.
The process of making the costumes for the movie was a lot to do with how the characters were evolving within the world of the movie. As I was making the dresses, and even before I was making the dresses, I was thinking about how I could use the elements, and even in some cases, the elements inspired the costume first.
I love working with Kim because we work very closely together and bats ideas off, and if I come up with something she likes, she'll run with it and design a costume around and makeup, and if she comes up with something fantastic, I can then take a makeup on to compliment what she's done.
I thought nothing would be harder than Cloud Atlas until Jupiter Ascended.
The great thing about Lara and Andy is that they are both very involved but also very trusting of you to come up with ideas.
They have been thinking about this film for so long, and the backstories are all kind of in their head. So we start off with what they think, and then as the character develops and it's costumed and we do a makeup design for it, the backstory is there, but then we can choose whether it's still relevant or not. So all the rules and the preconceptions you have about what you normally do on a film, you can throw out of the window. It's now about letting your imagination burst out and try and create images which we haven't seen before and yet identifiable.
Lana and Andy Wachowski create from a molecular level to the expanse of the universe. That is one thing they just do almost better than anyone in the game. What's unique about this sci-fi film is it starts off in a very real, very well-known city.
Familiarity and beginning with familiarity is always a helpful thing in science fiction. It gives you something to ground.
And then you get thrown into this insane sort of world that you have to relearn the rules of.
The Wachowskis typically don't want anything that people have seen before, so we're having to put a lot of work into trying to reconceive, visualize science fiction in a new way.
Andy and Lana have been wanting to do something original and new and thoughtful and visionary.
Your Majesty.
I think that's very brave of them. I play a character called Stinger Apini, who's half bee and half human.
Stinger?
This is where he is. This is the life he's being kind of forced into, really. It's a bit like exile. They've decided to put him away somewhere in the middle of nowhere, and it kind of reflects his personality to some extent.
Little sets that we did have, the tangible sets, were stunning and beautiful, and all were very much geared towards that characteristic of that character.
Pardon me, Lord Titus.
Only good news is allowed in here.
Titus's set was very grand and a lot of mahogany wood and very sexy and luscious.
Titus enjoys life. My servants are beautiful women, all of them. They're all gorgeous, and it kind of looks like Playboy Mansion.
For Titus's Clipper, we love the design of 20,000 Leagues Under the Sea, the Nautilus.
The components of the wings float and separate. It's inlaid with gold decoration. The main body of the ship has a complexity of a city. The internals are incredibly detailed and luxurious, like a super luxury yacht.
Why are spaceships so damn ugly? It's unbelievable how ugly they are, and they're ugly in so many movies. in the history of transportation. Every single era or epoch, whether you're talking about boats or cars or planes or trains, they're always a level of exquisitely designed ones, especially the rich people. I mean, rich people always travel in amazing aesthetic style. And so because this is an exploration of class, we were also curious about the spaceships for the super rich. What do they look like?
I confess I feel I have you at somewhat of a disadvantage.
Is that because you kidnapped me?
I think Titus is a great guy. I think he's just out to have fun. When it doesn't always go his way, he's like, oh well, next time.
Where am I?
This is the Alcazar of Kalique, Abrasax.
What's an Alcazar?
A fancy way of saying my home.
I am Kalique.
The intent was to represent it as an almost natural space that she had come across in perhaps her travels through the universe. So we looked at some of the most extraordinary vegetation and landscapes on our planet. We photographed waterfalls and landscape in Iceland, but then we colored the vegetation. They're all pushed very kind of, you know, purpley and red to match with the planet Cerise, of course.
The Alcazar of Kalique, where I live, is luxurious and very beautiful.
Candles everywhere and very Moroccanish.
Well, the palace itself was a mixture of aesthetics that included things like the Natural History Museum in London, because we went there to shoot practically some of the sequences, and the more Turkish, Middle Eastern looks to some of the structures and towers.
Come, let me introduce you to the possibilities of your new life.
She's very much about beauty. It's a kind of calm, indulgent, decadent world that she lives in.
Feel my skin.
The worlds Lana and Andy create are so wonderful. I can't think of anything this original since I saw Star Wars. It really is establishing that totally independent world.
Welcome, Your Majesty, to the overpopulated, oozing cesspool we humbly call home.
Arrus is described as the birthplace of humankind. Earth is really just one of many subsequent colonies that have been set up. So the sense of age and history that we wanted to convey with Arrus was massive. They're just piling this place up with a massively overpopulated, over-industrialized world.
Greetings, Your Majesty. I am Intergalactic Advocate Bob, here to assist you through the ascension process.
It has moons that have built up structures on them. The planet itself has these vast rings that slowly orbit and rotate around the planet like a vast gyroscope. Arrus is, I always thought, was one of the more beautiful designs that we came up with.
And then you had Eddie's character set. Which looked like a scary, frightening dungeon.
He's a damaged, an evil human being. He's softly spoken. He demands respect from people.
No, I want her found, and I want her dead.
There's clearly a lot of complicated things have happened to take him to the extremity that he lives at.
We did stick faithfully to the look of Jupiter as we know it from interplanetary probes for the exterior. But as you approach it, even the exterior, we introduce this idea of a spinning vortex that ships can take to lead them into a layer beneath the gases that is Balem's compound. The design for that was to build something that was a vast industrial space. So we built a lot of strange-looking, complicated, very, very detailed components and piping and gas jets. The idea was to have the swirling, ferocious gases of Jupiter itself always present as a character, really visible, just being somehow held back from completely destroying the place.
It's just such an extraordinary combination, this film, of something completely contemporary and modern and something science fiction and original. I have no idea how they've managed to meld all those worlds, but they have.
Lana and Andy created a world that will open your mind to understand that we are just a very small grain of sand in a ginormous beach of other possibilities.
The Wachowskis are the most detail-oriented directors when it comes to, like, sets and design that I've ever worked with. It's so in their head that even when they describe it or when you read the script, it never quite makes sense until you visually actually see it.